عليه النهارده هو الرول لو في الماجنتيك ريزونانس ايميجنج ايفالويشن اوف الفيتال هي الموست كومن فيتال برين ابنورمالتي دلوقتي البريفلنس اب تو فاليو اوف اراوند 22 بير 1000 بيرث الكونديشن موست ريبريزنتد ان ايزوليتد فور اور ان اسوسيشن وذ اذر ابنورمالتيز embryological hint كده ان the brain بيبقى developed in neural tube, neural plate which is formed in the fourth week of gestation. Later on بيحصل حاجة اسمها neurulation. The anterior both ends close, the anterior end gives the brain, the posterior end gives the spinal cord. Later on the neural tube takes certain constrictions and bending, giving the forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain vesicles that will cavitate containing CSF, tidini, forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain ventricles. The forebrain ventricle later on will give the lateral ventricles and the third, the midbrain ventricle will give the equiductal sylvus, the hindbrain ventricle will give the fourth ventricle. Roughly, the ventricular system is formed by two lateral ventricles, midline, third, and fourth ventricles. The two lateral ventricles are connected to the third via foramina of Monroe, with the third ventricle is connected to the fourth via the cerebral reproductive sinus. Most important part here is the confluence of the body. Sorry, the lateral ventricle is formed by the anterior horn, body, occipital horn, and temporal horns. The confluence of the body, occipital and temporal horns, is called the atrium. This part is important as when we measure it more than 10 millimeters, this gives us an idea of ventriculum, as we discussed later on. The choroid plexus is not found all over the lateral ventricle, in the ventricular system. It's found in the body of the lateral ventricle, the roof of the third ventricle, and the inferior roof of the fourth ventricle. Hint about the MRI anatomy of the ventricular system. During the first trimester, the ventricles and the extra axial CSF spaces column become prominent. Starting from the 18th week of gestation till the 20 weeks of gestation, the ventricular size remains normal, yet the cortical mantle increases in thickness as we see here. Increases in thickness in relation to the ventricular size. Later on, from the 20th to the 25th week of gestation, the occipital horns enlarge, giving corpocephalic configuration. After 25 weeks, the ventricle becomes smaller and they lose the corpocephalic configuration, giving the normal. Our topic is about ventriculomegaly. What's ventriculomegaly? Ventriculomegaly is the enlargement of the lateral cerebral ventricles without any cause, without increased intracranial pressure, or with no specific cause. Recently, fetal ventriculomegaly can be classified into isolated, obstructive, acquired, and syndromal and/or malformative type. Meanwhile, what's the hydrocephalus? It's the increase in the cerebral ventricular size and/or the subarachnoid space, which results from increasing the amount of the CSF inside the ventricle, with increased intracranial pressure, either imbalance of circulation or resorption or production of the cerebrospinal fluid. That's why hydrocephalus can describe the primary cerebral atrophy that causes the ventriculomegaly. Traditionally, hydrocephalus was classified communicating and non-communicating. Now, recently, it's classified into congenital and acquired. Now we'll talk about the congenital hydrocephalus. Why? Because fecal cerebral ventriculomegaly is almost always evident in all patients of the congenital hydrocephalus. As we see here, congenital hydrocephalus can be classified into simple, dysgenetic, and secondary. The simple hydrocephalus is that hydrocephalus due to certain small congenital change in the CSF pathway, as atresia or foramen of Monroe, equiductal stenosis, and so on. The dysgenetic hydrocephalus, it's hydrocephalus associated with CNS dysgenesis, as hydroencephaly, holoprosencephaly, carry malformation, and others. And lastly, the secondary congenital hydrocephalus, it's the hydrocephalus secondary to certain underlying lesion in the fetal period, as a tumor, post-hemorrhage, or post-infection. We'll discuss the technique of fetal MRI. Patient came, how can we deal with him? First of all, the preparation. Ultrasound should always be performed for medical legal purpose and to detect cardiac activity at first. Both parents should be extensively informed about the imaging procedure entirely, should be asked about any contraindication to the MR, including claustrophobia, with written informed consent about the procedure. The mother should fast before 84 hours to prevent any intestinal motion artifact or postprandial motion of the fetus, and the mother should enter the restroom before the examination, as the renal bladder may induce intestinal motion artifact. The MRI equipment we use, as we see here, a machine with 1.5 Tesla. This is our machine here in the Merdash Hospital. We can use this machine with 1.5 Tesla strengths. And the coils used also. These are our coils and those from the end. Our coils here, the multi-channel based array coil, which gives increased coverage to the fetal head with increased signal-to-noise ratio. How we position the patient? The patient lies in a supine position with feet first. If she can't afford it with back pain or compression of the inferior vena cava, she can lie on her left side, but this gives increased spatial resolution when compared to the supine position. The MRI examination, how long would it take? The beta MR protocol should be designed at maximum 20 to 30 minutes. We have several sequences as we see here. Steady state precession sequence, which is called the Fiesta, fixed lab imaging, T2 weighted ultra fast single shot fast spin echo or HAST sequence, the high resolution T1 fast spoiled radial echo T1 sequence, functional sequences, and echo planner MR. Let's discuss a hint about each of them. First of all, the steady state precession sequence. What's it? It's the scout that we use. It renders a stack of images through the maternal uterus in different planes in multiplanar imaging, sagittal, axial, and coronal views. This is my scout image. It's in thickness of 6 to 8 millimeter and 1 to 2 millimeter gap in between. Here we use the CSF. The CSF gives hyper intense signal and excellently delineates the anatomic features of the fetus as we see here. There is another alternative to this scout view, which is called the fixed lab image. It's a heavy T2-weighted MR photography sequence that serves as an alternative, as we said. Why we call it the fixed lab imaging? Because we take thick sequences, 80 to 120 millimeter thickness. It gives better anatomic details. CSF is also hyper intense. We can see the umbilical cord, the extremities of the fetus. It gives anatomical details which are more accurate than the previous model. Here comes the money image of the whole examination, which is the T2-weighted ultra-fast single-shot fast spin echo, the HAST sequence or the half Fourier single-shot third spin echo. This is the backbone of the fetal imaging. It can give us a normal and pathologic fetal anatomy. Why? Because it can picture freeze the fetus intrauterine. It's a very, very fast sequence. We can take one sequence in less than 500 milliseconds. As we see here, it gives excellent anatomy in the coronal views of the brain, starting from the face until posterior. Here, part of the CSF appears hyper intense and excellently delineating the brain. Here in the Merdash Hospital, we mainly use the steady state precession sequence and the T2 sequence. Later on, we can use, this is not used here in our unit, but according to the papers, there is high resolution T1 weighted image. It's used outside Yang as a complementary HAST sequence if I'm looking for any intracranial hemorrhage collection of fat as lipoma or teratoma. The disadvantage of this sequence is too long acquisition time. We can take 15 to 18 images in 15 to 18 seconds. The current and the T2 weighted sequence is long acquisition time. We can also use the functional sequences, the most important of which is the diffusion weighted imaging. It provides quantitative information about the water motion and tissue microstructure that can be used to identify any local area of injury or ischemia. We take 5 B values starting from 100 to 1000. Whenever we increase the B value, the anatomical details decrease, but increase sensitivity to detect any ischemic changes or profile of ischemia. There is another protocol, which is the echo planner MRI. It's an alternative for fetal MR examination because it's ultra short imaging time. It can be taken in less than 100 milliseconds. Yet it's limited by many artifacts, such as the susceptibility artifact, field distortion, chemical shift artifact, and the anatomical details are suboptimal to the current and the different protocols that we use. We had an overview about fetal MR. I should ask myself, when does the fetal MR is recommended? The leading indication to perform fetal MR whenever we suspect CNS anomaly, which represents 31% of cases, or ventricular dilatation, which represents 30% of cases for the MR done. How can I know that the patient is already having ventriculomegaly? Ventriculomegaly is diagnosed prenatally by ultrasound. This is my first tool. How we can diagnose it? Already we see this is an axial transventricular view, in the level of the thalamine. We measure at the atrium, as I told you before, this is the part we measure the ventricles at. The atrium will be equal or more than 10 millimeters. And of course, we can diagnose ventriculomegaly as we see here if there is a distance more than 3 millimeters between the glomus of the choroid plexus and the medial wall of the lateral ventricle. Now the physician should ask himself, this is a case diagnosed as ventriculomegaly. is it isolated or it has any other abnormality associated with it? Is it ventricular megaly only or it's associated with anything else? Here comes the use of fetal cam form. Ventricular megaly can be classified into mild, moderate, and severe according to the measurement. In case of sonographically detected ventricular megaly, fetal MR is performed. It can directly visualize all the structures of the fetal brain, gives tissue contrast when compared to ultrasound. We can find the etiology of ventricular megaly as well as we can detect the neurodevelopmental outcome. If it's isolated, then the outcome is better than it's accompanied by other CNS animals, as in this genetic talk. Let's discuss some of the MR manifestations of various causes of the congenital hydrocephalus. The equiductal stenosis is the most common type of the simple congenital hydrocephalus. We can see here there is supratentorial dilatation of the lateral ventricles and the third ventricle, yet the fourth ventricle is normal in size. This is a case of equiductal stenosis. Another example of the dysgenetic hydrocephalus, there is the hydranencephaly. Here the brain is completely replaced by CSF with remnants of the thalamic occipital lobe. We can identify it easily by MR by the presence of an intact fault to differentiate it from the allobar type of holoprosencephaly. The holoprosencephaly, the allobar type, there is absent internium steric fissure, fault cerebri and septum pilocytum. There is only one large monoventricle with fused thalami, and also the MR helps and serves in detecting any facial abnormalities. As we see here, there is hypotyreosis. In the semi-lobar type, there is partial cleavage of the two lobes and H-shaped lateral ventricles, well-formed occipital and slightly remnants of the temporal lobe and rudimentary faults. The Dandy-Walker spectrum, it can be easily diagnosed by a triad. First of all, aplasia or hypoplasia of the vermis, secondly, dilated fourth ventricle and its connection to the cisterna magna giving the keyhole appearance, and thirdly, the hydrocephalus. In addition, we can see here the third layer of villi is in a elevated position than the normal field. The Arnold-Chiari malformation, it can be easily diagnosed here by MR. We can see small posterior fossa with concave clivus, supratentorially there is ventricular megaly, and at the level of the cervical region, we can see that the medulla is found behind the cervical part of the spinal cord with narrowing of the fourth ventricle. The MR also serves as a whole body MR till the age of 26 or 27 weeks of gestation. We can see here an accompanying myelomeningeal C in the case of Chiari II malformation. Also, lissencephaly, we find here a shallow sulci with broad gyri and thickened cortex. Some types of lissencephaly, there is thickening of the meninges that impair the CSF circulation and cause hydrocephalus. Dysgenesis of the corpus callosum can be easily diagnosed here by certain characteristic features. There is cleavage and no connection at all between the two cerebral hemispheres. There is the reeds, stern horn appearance of the frontal horn. Frontal horns, we've achieved an occipital horns, we were dilated, which give a pulpocephalic configuration. And in the sagittal view, you just see the rostrum and abscess. This is type of a partial and not complete agenesis of the corpus callosum. We can see the rostrum and then absence of the body and skin. Hemimegalencephaly, there is enlargement of one cerebral hemisphere with ipsilateral dilatation of the ventricles. Schizencephaly, there is a cleft connecting the subarachnoid space with the lateral ventricles. The MRI can excellently serve in delineating this lesion to differentiate it from porencephalic cyst. In schizencephaly, it's lined by gray matter, while in porencephaly, it's lined by white matter. Also, from the secondary types of congenital hydrocephalus that can result from tumor, the MR can excellently give us different sequence to describe the tumor, its site, its signal, whether it contains fat or not, areas of degeneration, and we can know its type. The most common type of fetal tumors are teratomas followed by craniopharyngeals. And here's the porencephaly and the cephalomalacia. As we see, they are lined by white matter to differentiate it from I already said it. Sorry? But the most important part is the advantage of fetal MR. أنا ليه أعمله أصلاً؟ ماشي، non-invasive, safe diagnostic modality للست الحامل دايما. وحالياً no definite evidence خالص إن فيه harmful effect على الفيميل أو الفيتس. كمان هو independent of the amniotic fluid volume. يعني بس مرات إن لو هي عندها oligo epidermis أنا مش عارف أشوف كويس. لو مثلا الفيميل تدوس شوية هنا أنا completely ماليش علاقة بالماتيريال سوماتوتايب. مع الوقت لما بيحصل calvary justification مش هعرف أعمل transvaginal مش هعرف إن أنا أعمله صمام كويس. هيبقى في reverberation effect هنا اللي عندي. الماتيريال pelvic skeleton هي اللي بيتخينا السكيلتون مش شغالين بشكل كويس. أقدر أعمل visualization لكل sides of the brain without any artifact. Very rapid image acquisition بقدر اشوف اناتومي كويس. الفيتال ام ار هي فول بودي ام ار اقدر اشوف جسمه كله من فوق لتحت من 27 ل 28 ويكس وكمان اقدر اشوف اي كرينيو فيشال انوماليز معاه. لكن اكيد ليه ليميتيشنز. طبعا هو نون ريال تايم قصادي مش بشوف البيبي بيتحرك. ليميتد افيلابيلتي اند كوست. الجستيشنال ايج بيفرق امبورتنت فاكتور. كل ما كان البيبي لسه صغير ممكن يكون الباثولوجي لسه ما كملش وحجم الاناتومي صغير فبحتاج ان انا اشوف اكرر الام ار تاني ان يا اما في اواخر الحمل في ليتر ويكس اوف جستيشن يا اما بوست ليتر. السبيشال ريزولوشن بتاعت الفيتال ام ار لسه ليميتد حجمه صغير مقارنه بالبوست ليتر. ما عنديش الترا فاست تي 1 ويتد سيكونس. انا كويس عندي الترا فاست والتي 2 مش التي 1 ان اديشن للابسوليوت كونترا انديكيشنز الموجوده عندي في الام ار والماتيريال كولوستروفول. التيك هوم مسج الفنتريكلوماجالي هي الموست كومن فيتال برين ابنورماليتي. هي النون سبيسيفيك دايلاتيشن اوف ذا لاترال فنتريكلز في السكند وفي الثيرد تريمستر كان ديجريدد زي ما قلنا مايلد ومودريت وسيفير. لازم ابقى عارفه انها دايما ريبريزنت ذا تيب اوف ان ايسبرج اوف ا ماتش مور كومبلكس اندرلاين باثولوجي. مش بس اقول فنتريكلوماجالي بس اكيد في حاجات ثانيه استشهدها معاها. الفيتال سيربرال فنتريكلوماجالي از ايفيدنت ان موست اوف ذا بيشنتس اوف كونجنيتال هيدروكيفالس. Congenital hydrocephalus is classified into three categories, the more simple, dysgenetic, and secondary. Although ultrasound remains the primary modality of choice for fetal screening, fetal MR represents an imaging technique that serves as a complementary diagnostic tool. The main indication to confer in assessment of ventriculomegaly, to determine the etiology, maximize the detection of any CNS anomaly, to evaluate the outcome. Fetal MR also proved to be superior over ultrasound in other main fields such as the posterior cranial fossa defect, corpus callosum malformation, complex brain anomalies, ischemia, hemorrhage, and also evaluating neurodegenerative. Thank you for listening.